exercises. So just get on there and Google those, and them are super, super good for you. All right, so pelvic floor exercise is good. Make sure that you get off of all caffeine. Caffeine is a diuretic, and if you have a urinary tract infection, and if it's hard for you to actually urine, since caffeine is a diuretic, it's going to try to make you urine more, which is going to build up more pressure because you're so swollen. So then you're going to back and fill up the actual bladder even more. And there's a difference between a bladder and a gallbladder, y'all. The gallbladder holds your bowel. The regular bowel holds your secretion of your urine, or what you would call metabolic waste. So we're talking about the bladder that's connected to the urinary tract system, and not the gallbladder, which is connected to the actual pancreas and liver and small duodenum intestinal tract, or what they will call the small digestional tract of the stomach. So we talking about the actual bladder. So that's good. So we have to do the exercises, Kegel exercises. Just strengthening and trying to hold your pee even when you don't have to pee. This actually strengthens up the fibers and the muscles of the actual penis. Getting off of all caffeine. Also get off of red meat. Red meat is actually full of what you will call heterocyclic amines. Heterocyclic amines, or what they call HCA, is actually bad for the prostate because it forms a bunch of proteins, and these proteins are very, very acidic to the body. And I don't know why, but the first thing it does is it swells up the prostate, and we can look that up as well. Let's look this up real quick too. I just want to show y'all all of this stuff for yourselves, and y'all can all Google this stuff yourselves, or y'all can search for scholarly articles, or pay a monthly subscriptions for the institutes, and they will give you this stuff, y'all. Heterocyclic HCA and prostate enlargement. And it's all here, y'all. It's taking me to HCA Florida. Let me spell it out. Heterocyclic amines causes prostate enlargement. So here it go right here. And this is an article right here y'all can read that'll bring this up. And this is by the National Library of Medicine. Where is the article number at? All right, so this is going to be article number PMC3552388. And it's just basically talking about inflammation in the prostate of carcinogens. And it's talking about heterocyclic amines in red meat. And y'all can look this up. So the first thing I'm going to do to get anybody to keep your prostate from swelling or becoming mutation cancerous cells is I'm going to tell you to get off of all meat. But specifically, make sure you get off of red meat, because heterocyclic amines is basically a hydrocarbon. Is when you cook your food and you put that char on there, it's actually cancerous causing charcoal that's created from you. Cooking at meat, and it's called heterocyclic amine hydrocarbons, which is very, very cancerous causing. So we can cross that out. The next one is I was talking about doing the pelvic floor squeezes. All right, and then make sure you're sitting down when you're urinating. When you sit down when you're urinating, this actually relaxes the abdominal walls, and it relaxes your anus. And you don't have to put so much pressure on the bladder or on the urethra. So when you're urinating, sit down and breathe while you're peeing. This will actually open up those flows for you, and you can get more out. And I'm pretty sure it's pretty painful. And then as far as your actual hemorrhoids, hydration. Hydration is very, very good for hemorrhoids. If I was you, I'll increase my liquid intake to about 50 ounces of spring water a day. I wouldn't do too many juices. I wouldn't do too many juices, because when you do the juices become a super, super diuretic. And then that super diuretic, again, it creates that PSI. And then you got all of this stuff in your bladder that you can't get out because you got that swelling going on there. And it's going to start backing up anymore. And then you can get a stomach lining infection. And then you actually need to get checked, though. So go get checked. Have them check your prostate. Have them do an infection check on you to make sure that you don't have an affected urinary tract. If you don't have an affected urinary tract, check the bladder. See if you got a bladder infection. If it was me, I would not take any of the antibiotics, because you actually need those microorganisms and those good gut bacteria to rebuild your structure and to keep you healthy. I will actually take the healthy way out. Saw palmetto berries is very, very good for the prostate. So get you some saw palmetto berries. That's good for the prostate. Another thing is stinky nettle root. Stinky nettle root and stinky nettle leaf is very, very good for the prostate as well. Another one is marshmallow root. Marshmallow root is good for the prostate because marshmallow root is one of your highly anti-inflammatory herbs on the planet. Another one is called corn silk ears. Corn silk ears is my number two when it comes to anti-inflammatory herbs. The purple corn silk ears. And it's literally the ears of a corn, but make sure it's purple. That's very good for you as well. And then the last one is white willow bark. White willow bark is good as well. So take these herbs. I wouldn't do them as capsules. I actually do them as teas. And look, you'll be okay. And then if you need to get the essential glandular kit off the site, go get that. And it'll help you regulate your hormones better. You need to regulate your hormones because swelling prostates is basically an unregulated hormone issue in black males and in women. So when women go through their menopause, when women go through ovarian cancer, when women go through POS, PCOS, when they go through their thyroids, that's an imbalance in hormones as well due to the same system, which is the pituitary gland. So that's what we're going through. And there's new studies coming out now, y'all, that's showing that prostate swelling is not due to old age. It's due to hormone imbalances while you're aging. So if we can fix the hormones and learn how to balance the hormones correctly, well, guess what? We don't actually get prostate swelling anymore, what they call prostate enlargement. So that's what you need to do. All right. If y'all got any questions so far on that, y'all can ask them now. And if not, we're going to move on to the next question. Yes, the lungs or the wings. I agree with you. What else we got? Y'all got any questions so far on that? What causes migraines? It can be pressure in your head, hydrostatic pressure, oncotic pressure, glymphatic system that's not draining pressure, the lack of minerals. You probably need to get you a couple Celtic salt shots, a couple of lemon shots, breathing exercises. Probably need to open up your nasal passage. Being in the wrong latitude and longitude will bring on these oncotic symptomologies. So it all depends on. That's why when you're going through stuff, you got to go all the way around. You got to check every system. That way you can narrow things down. And I think that's a good thing to use the doctors for. You know, the thing to use the doctors for to me is diagnosing and surgery. You know, to me, the allopathic community is good at that. Now, when it comes to facilitating healing, I think they do a very, 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 very bad piss poor job. When it comes to detoxification and cellular regeneration, I think they do a piss poor job. But when it comes to surgery and it comes from using their machinery to diagnose, I think they do a pretty good job. Because, you know, the eyes is only so much iridology reading is going to show you. It's only so much where I can look in your eyes and see what that's going to show you. That's going to show your genetic patterns, your genetic weaknesses, and your genetic strengths. You know, the X-ray will show you more. MRI can show you more. You know, using color contrast to act and dyes to go into the bloodstream. These things show you more. I mean, they do. Now, is they cancerous causing? Hell yeah. You going behind some radiation, you know, they do mess up the cells a little bit. But we know what's going on and we can clean up the radiation through the detoxification process. So the only time I really recommend going to the allopathic community is if you need surgery from a life-threatening condition, or you really don't know what's going on with your system and you need to get checked metabolically for them to tell you what's going on. And then you take that information and then you go to your holistic health nutrition and then you let them help you facilitate the rest. All right, so next question. I see I ain't had no questions for that. So the next one is, it says, hello, Yahki. I love your teachings. Can you please tell me how to get rid of H. pylori, Helicobacter pylori? Everybody talking about that. Helicobacter have got such a bad name, and it's just in the wrong place. It's kind of like being in the wrong place at the wrong time. Your body naturally produces Helicobacter pylori. When you read on Google and you read some of their scientific articles, they will tell you that they tell you that Helicobacter pylori comes from, you know, eating certain foods. They tell you it comes from slopping out saliva and all this other stuff. But Helicobacter pylori is already naturally within your body. It do a good job when it's actually in past the pyloric sphincter and the duodenum. But when it passes the pyloric sphincter and goes into the stomach, it do a very, very bad job because it starts chewing and eating away at all the mucosa inside the stomach lining. And then it starts creating things like leaky gut, and it creates ulcers or ursitis or something like that. So the bacteria is not bad, and the bacteria is not the blame. It's when the bacteria is misplaced because of things that you're eating, and the environment that you're putting your cells in is going to change or pleomorph the bacteria to change their job and their position. If your body is full of trash and waste, guess what the bacteria turns into? They turn into parasites, or they pleomorphize themselves into parasites to get rid of the metabolic waste. You see that? If your body is super, super, I don't want to say body is super alkaline because it don't sound right, because your body can't be super alkaline. But if you are bringing in more alkaline foods than acidic forming foods, then the bacteria loves to ferment things. So they'll be your fermenters where they'll break down your food, or they'll be your trash cans where they'll come and eat the things that the fermentation can't break down. It's the same bacteria, but it will pleomorphize itself and change and have a different role depending on the environment that you put your cells in. You see what I'm saying? So when you have too many acids inside of your stomach and your hydrochloric acid is too high, you have too much mucus building up there because you're eating mucus and acidic forming foods, the actual bacteria Helicobacter pylori will be in this little 9-inch section of your stomach called the duodenum or duodenum. It will actually pass through the pyloric sphincter and go in the stomach because it feels like that it needs to help you clean up things. The only thing is they do their job too well, so they start eating and chewing away up all this excessive mucus, and then they start chewing through the lining of the stomach. Now you got ulcers and you have things like that. So you can't really get rid of Helicobacter pylori. What you can do is get rid of the excessive acid builds up and excessive mucus that's building up in your actual stomach or abdominal area, and then it will go back to the pyloric sphincter along with the Candida albicans, the lactose bacillus, and everything else, and the bifidobacterium bacteria, and be where it need to be, and it'll stop wreaking havoc on your body. So what I've been noticing and how we've been helping getting rid of Helicobacter pylori infestation is we do Manuka honey. A tablespoon of Manuka honey when you first wake up on an empty stomach. We've been incorporating more fermentating foods into the body. I love sauerkraut. Get you some organic cabbage, and then you're going to literally ferment it. And you can drink the fermented juice from the cabbage and eat the cabbage. That's very good for you as well. And last but not least is sulforaphane. Sulforaphane come from the brassica family, or what we'll call the cruciferous family. And we can look this up as well. It showed that how sulforaphane from Brussels sprouts and sulforaphane from different types of broccolis and kale actually helps get rid of H. pylori because of the sulfates, or this natural sulfur that's accumulated within inside of these vegetables. And the one thing that Helicobacter pylori hate is sulfur. Hate sulfur. So if you can bring in some natural sulfates, guess what? It's going to get out of the stomach and it's going to go right where it needs to be. And we can look up that article as well. So let me show y'all that. Sulforaphane gets rid of Helicobacter pylori.
According to WebMD, you can treat the symptoms of an H. pylori infection with proton pump inhibitors, PPIs, and H2 blockers. Treatment takes about 2 weeks. Once the bacteria are gone,
I said sulforaphane. This mug says so far a thing. I know I'm talking. I talked that messed up, y'all. Sulforaphane. I think I spelled it right. We're going to see. Okay, here it go. Look. Boy. And this is from the actual National Institute of Health. And they just talk about how sulforaphane have strong bacterial side activity against H. pylori. See that? In vitro. Moreover, sulforaphane is highly active against large number of clinical isolates of Helicobacter pylori or H. pylori. It says many of which are resistant to conventional antibiotics. So this article that is from the National Institute of Health actually telling you that eating broccoli and eating kale and eating Brussels sprouts and eating things that's a part of the cruciferous brassica family actually have more of effect on H. pylori or Helicobacter pylori than the actual antibiotics that they actually prescribe to you at the hospitals, y'all. You see what I'm saying? And if you look at these articles, always go down two-day experiment. Always go down to their two-day results and always look at their statistics and what they did to find their results. And you will see if they did them in laboratories or not. You actually see and find if they did them in laboratories or not. And that's the problem and the issue that I have with amygdalin being in celery. Yes, I did find it, but where is the articles showing that the scientists actually took the celery, did the experiments, broke down the compounds, and actually showed that amygdalin came from these? You know, we need to see the experiments. We need to see them. Same thing. That's why we test so much stuff and we send so much stuff to the laboratories, because people can lie in science. I have a book right now called We Are the Experts, Listen to Us. Let me show y'all this book. And this book is deep, y'all. And the book is talking about how the government is paying certain scientists billions of dollars to lie, to push a certain narrative. And they lying through articles, y'all. I mean, they out flat out lying. Let me look. Check this out. I should have brought that book now, B.
Yeah.
We Are the Experts.
No, we bring
them. Yep, Listen to Us book. Man, this book blew my mind, man. Where is this book at? Huh, find that book for me. It's called We Are the Experts, Listen to Us. Or Listen to Us, We Are the Experts. Now, B gonna find it. So, man, it's crazy. So just think about that, though. The government paying a scientist billions of dollars, or they giving them a budget. They giving them a budget of $200 million. And then they say, look, do the experiment. But within that experiment, make it look like what I want it to look for. We can get more money from the lenders. And then they be behind there shaking up some shit. You know what I'm saying? Basically, falsifying evidence and falsifying the experiment to push a certain narrative and outcome. And then me and you come start arguing with each other over their findings when the damn prerequisite of the findings was falsified anyway. And me and you hate each other. Me and you hate each other guts over scientific articles. Here go the book. See, not be my man. It's my dude. So look. This book will blow your mind, y'all. And it's on Amazon. It's called Trust Us, We're the Experts. Trust Us, We're the Experts. And it says, lies, damn lies, public relations, image, industry, science, and government. And it's talk about manipulation in the science industry. And, man, it talks about toxic sludge, how they hide stuff from us, how they just put propaganda out there to change our mindsets. The author of this book is... Who is the author, Nabi?
I'll call it out.
Yeah, call it out for that. And make sure y'all download that book, y'all. I'm talking about, man, it'll blow your mind. And y'all wonder why we, yeah.
Sheldon Rampton. That's Rampton.
Sheldon Rampton.
Yeah, and John C. Staubeer, which is Staubeer.
All right, make sure y'all download that book, y'all. It'll blow your mind. You talking about not trusting a damn thing? Why y'all think y'all be thinking I'm so crazy with the information and why I don't believe things? And we spend over $250,000 a year just on laboratory results for a reason, because we be having to do our own experiment. We be having to do our own stuff. I need to go in the laboratory and see this stuff myself, because we know how people be lying with the information. They've been doing this for years, y'all. But sulforaphane is good for Helicobacter pylori. Manuka honey is very, very good for Helicobacter pylori. What else is good? Fermentation. Make sure you do fermented onions, fermented pickles, or what you would call pickled onions or pickled cucumbers. Make sure you do them yourself at the house. These things are very, very good for H. pylori. And what we be using for H. pylori is my three bitters, the three bitters. Bitter one in particular, because bitter one actually have what you would call a hydrangea root in it. It actually have your cassia chips or your cassia woods. And that replaces the good bacteria in the gut. So that's what I would do if I was you. Any questions so far for this particular case? If not, we can keep it going. Yeah, y'all asking pretty easy questions today. Brother, can you speak about the brothers with prostates? Brother, I promise you, when we went live, that was the first question asked, King. Yes, it's called Trust Us, We Are the Experts.
I'm posting it in the comment board.
Now, B is posting in the comment board, y'all. It just shows y'all the trickery and lies of the science community, man. Y'all ain't gonna. I'm just gonna answer their questions because they keep asking. They don't even want me to read. I'm just gonna answer y'all questions. Come on, call in. Let's see what we got. Who we got? Let's see who we got. Come on in. Brother, could you help with your sperm count? You need to check your seminal fluid. Usually people's sperm count be high, but you have something called an ejaculatory spout or canal that usually be shut off, and you can't get the sperm out properly. So you start looking at the color of your sperm, and your sperm be looking more watery than that off-white substance. That can be a sign of infertility. All right. Also, you need to be looking at zinc, copper, and selenium. Zinc, copper, and selenium could be missing from your seminal composition when making up your sperm, and that will make you very, very infertile too. So you might be mineral deficient. If I was you, I would get more zinc, copper, and selenium. What you need to do is you need to do a metabolic chart. You need to go to your doctor, and you need to get a metabolic chart done, a CBC done, and you need to get a mineral chart done so they can check all the mineral content that's in your bloodstream. And I bet you're missing selenium, you lacking zinc, and you lacking copper. And you need all three of these minerals to actually be able to reproduce, brother. Usually when people are infertile, that's what's messing up, or their testicles are not always at the right temperature. So check your testicles too. See if it's away from your body a lot. See if it's inside your body a lot. Maybe your temperature regulation is wrong. And what regulates your temperature is your thyroid gland and your parathyroid. So it might be a basal problem as well. And all basal mean is the basement cells of the follicular cells that makes up your thyroid. So you probably have a temperature issue. That's why, you know, you see men with their balls hang low, or if you a man that have balls that hang low, it's because the body core temperature is too hot. And what the body does it protects its future generations, so the nut sack start hanging far away from the body for it can cool off the actual testicles, for that sperm won't heat up to a certain temperature and you kill all of the sperm. Or if you get too cold, notice that the penis shrink and the ball shrink back up into the body for they can get heat again, for it can keep that incubation and keep that life going on inside of the testicles. So whenever you see somebody that's infertile, it's either a mineral deficiency or it's a temperature unregulated problem that they actually need to fix. And always, if you're infertile, don't drink no alcohol, don't smoke any cigarettes, or don't smoke any weed. You shouldn't be doing hookahs. You shouldn't be smoking anything or drinking anything. Drink your juices, drink your water, eat fruits, vegetables, and herbs, and try to do it as raw as possible. And usually that'll cause a detoxification. You can get rid of all of basically the toxemia that's in the body. You can bring in more minerals that's in the body, and then boom, you having sex and you making babies. I tried to accept somebody, but it didn't accept them. Let me accept somebody else. Let's see him come in. Thank you for the tea, Nabi. Appreciate it, brother. Peace, peace. Peace, God. How you feeling, brother? What's your name? Where you from, man?
Man, I'm from Richmond, California. My name's Joe.
Richmond, Cali, man. I was out there in the Bay, man, mm-hmm. over there in Oakland, and I rode through Richmond, man. It's a straight hood out there, bro.
Oh, yeah. Man, it's a jungle out here.
I rode through the projects. As I was riding through the projects, bro, I seen I literally seen like 2,000 Mexicans knocking them down. Like, they straight bro, knocking the projects down, hey, down there. And this was like 3 years ago, brother.
It's real out here. I'm telling you, a lot of people don't make it. Like, if I don't know if y'all know or if you heard of, but the artist Tayway the AK, he just recently got killed out here. You know, he was a big artist. He got the song Fuck It Up that's been going crazy around the world. You know what I'm saying? But tap in, real Richmond though. But yeah.
So I got a question before you ask your question. Did they end up knocking all them projects? Is they all gone now?
Man, gentrification is real. You know what I'm saying?
I was seeing it happening when I was there, brother.
It's people out here trying to keep the streets alive, but you know, they really getting us out and getting the others in. You know what I mean?
Yeah, RP to that brother too, man. What's going on with you? How can I help you, King?
Okay, well, first, man, I heard about you from my grandfather because he's been having like random shockings. He had a stroke, and then he had these random shockings that's happening in his brain. It's like he shocks, and then he makes these weird faces. He can't stop. His eyes start watering.
It's like trembling. It's kind of like how you have an earthquake.
Yeah.
And then after the earthquake, you have trembles that happen up to 6 months after the initial earthquake. So that mean that stroke actually struck a nerve, and that nerve might still be contracted, and then it's trying to release itself. But when it's releasing itself, since there's so much contraction there, he start getting them trembles that's going on. Yeah. So I got a question. After he had his stroke, did he get any type of paralyzation on any side of his body?
Yes.
Like, is his mouth twisted?
His face was paralyzed. I mean, paralyzed. And it dropped. Like, it started to drop. Like, his cheeks, his nose, and both his cheeks and his nose, it dropped, and he couldn't move.
What about his arms and his legs? He still got mobility in his arms and legs?
The mobility is fine. Paralyzed in the face, and like I said, the shocking in his brain, like, and it's exactly what you just said, the nerve problem.
So I got a question. What about his speech? Can he still speak good, or he's speaking with a slur?
Yes, big slur. He can barely talk. He stutters a lot. He repeat himself over and over, and then he be trying to think of the things he's trying to say. He know what he's trying to say, but he can't get it out.
He can't get it out because of the connection. All right, now my last question. Is can he drink and can he eat comfortably, or do how is his drinking and eating since he is paralyzed on one side?
My grandfather is a track coach, and he was a wrestling star back in the day. Like, he's a real healthy man. So he eats healthy, like, but don't get me wrong, you know, we black people, you know what I'm saying? Well, color folk, you know what I'm saying? So we eat how we eat, but you know, it's probably we do a little seasoning here, a little over seasoning, but you know, we eat right. But he is a person who will tell you no and eat very healthy.
So if he willing to change his diet, I can give you a quick little protocol that'll help him out tremendously. And this is what we do to any of stroke victims. This is what we do. We immediately take them off of meat. We take them off of all cooked foods, especially when it comes to seed oils. We don't recommend you frying anything because it gives you that unsaturated fatty acids,
right.
And this stuff is very, very bad for the nervous system. So what we do is we put people on an all raw diet that's high in berries. Whenever you need to get oxygen and need to get more circulation and blood to the actual brain or to the head to rebuild those cells, berries, man. Berries, berries, berries. Berries have antioxidants in them. Berries are our oxygenators. Berries prolong lives, and berries actually promote new brain tissue and new neurological pathways. So what I would do is berries. Now, it is something that you can pan sear for him, and it will be lion's mane. I will most definitely get him on lion's mane. You can get him on this herb called go-to cola. Go-to cola is very, very good. Go-to cola is spelled G-O-T-U cola.
Okay.
K-A-L-A, I believe. It's another one called ginkgo.
And so which one of your products, because he recently told me that he purchased all three of your three bitters in the, I think it's a tea and three bitters, I think it's called.
You got his order number? If you got his order number, we'll check it out and make sure it gets sent out ASAP.
I couldn't tell you that.
So look, get his order number and DM me his order number tonight if you can, and I'll make sure it get out to him tomorrow.
I can definitely do that. He definitely bought the three teas and the bitter. But I just wanted to ask you, based on what I had a two-part question. The first one was, he bought the, based on everything I just said about the shocking, the stirring, the face, the stuff like that with the nerve problem, I'm high.
It's all good.
Weed.
So look, the three bitter, no, so if you high, that ain't all good, because I mean, you probably smoked.
No. I'm saying, my question is, did he buy the right product?
So the three bitters is an initial of full body detoxification. It's like a beginning detoxification. That's what it is.
Okay.
What he gonna need, he have more of a serious injury, because he got what you would call nervous system or neurological brain damage from the stroke.
Right.
What I would have did with him is I would have brought the geogenetic therapeutic package level one. And if y'all didn't want to do that and spend that much money, I would at least got him the actual nervous system kit. You should have got him the nervous system kit, or you should have got him the actual geogenetic therapeutic package level one. And with that package, I will put him on a 90% fruit diet, and then a 10% will be my winging percentage. Since I know that he probably stubborn and stuck in his ways, that 10%, I let him play around in that. And then 90% of the diet, all fruits, high in berries. Okay. And how tall is he? Pretty tall?
Nah, he about 5'5".
How much?
Nah.
How much he weigh? What, 120, 150?
Yeah, so under the 50, like 130, 120. Like,
see, and I make sure I put him on at least 50 ounces of liquids a day. And my liquids will consist of
juices, berries, I mean berries, juices, and melon juices and spring water. He needs severe hydration, because what we're trying to do is we're basically trying to regenerate neurological tissues. And if we can do that, we can get new neurological functions. So don't forget about the mushroom kingdom, though. The mycelium kingdom is very, very good for the brain, especially when you start talking about lion's mane, you start talking about your trumpets, you start talking about your reishi, you start talking about things like that. Very, very good for brain cognition, brain cognitive functions. You see what I'm saying? And then berries. So stick with the berries, stick with the mushrooms, pin sear the mushrooms. Don't use no actual seed oils. Get them on high fruits.